Up to this day, we treat depression according to monoamine theory. We believe that depression is caused by deficiency of neurotransmission, which can be caused by low levels of serotonin and norepinephrine and to a lesser extent dopamine in the synapse. So we believe that depression is caused by decreasing amount of serotonin and norepinephrine in the synapse. So how to treat depression? The most obvious approach is to increase the amount of serotonin and norepinephrine in the synapse. And drugs that cause increase in serotonin or norepinephrine in the synapse we call antidepressants. One of the antidepressants called bupropion. Bupropion is a typical antidepressant because of his multiple effects. First of all, bupropion inhibits the function of norepinephrine transporter. And to explain this, we have to know how adrenergic neurons work. So we have presynaptic neuron, synapse, and postsynaptic neuron. Adrenergic neurons uptake tyrosine. Once tyrosine appears inside the neuron, tyrosine undergo hydroxylation by rate-limiting enzyme tyrosine hydroxylase with formation of L-DOPA. Then L-DOPA by DOPA decarboxylase is converted to dopamine. Once dopamine is formed, vesicular monoamine transporter puts dopamine inside the vesicles. In the vesicles, dopamine molecules undergo conversion to norepinephrine. And in this form, norepinephrine is stored inside the neuron. But once depolarization occurs, neuron pushes vesicle into the synapse. We call this process exocytosis. As a result, vesicle becomes destroyed and norepinephrine molecules income to the synapse. On postsynaptic neuron, we have numerous adrenergic receptors. It's alpha-1 receptor, beta-1 receptor, and beta-2 receptor. Once norepinephrine molecules appear in the synapse, most of them immediately bind to adrenergic receptors. With binding, they activate adrenergic receptors, and the activation of adrenergic receptors improve mood and increase energy. Some of the norepinephrine molecules bind to alpha-2 receptor on presynaptic neuron, which is autoreceptor. With activation, this receptor inhibits the exocytosis of norepinephrine vesicles into the synapse. So this receptor provides reciprocal regulation. But what happens to norepinephrine molecules that simply did not have time to bind to any receptor? On presynaptic neuron, we have norepinephrine transporter called NAT. This transporter uptakes free norepinephrine molecules and delivers them back to the presynaptic neuron, where the big bad boy monoamine oxidase B waiting for them. Most of the delivered norepinephrine molecules have a tragic fate. Monoamine oxidase uptake and destroy them. But some norepinephrine molecules are able to slip away from monoamine oxidase, and such molecules income to norepinephrine molecules inside the vesicles, thereby replenishing norepinephrine pool. Bupropion inhibits the function of norepinephrine transporter. With inhibition of NAT, the reuptake of norepinephrine into the presynaptic neuron decreases. So monorepinephrine molecules will remain in the synapse, where now these free norepinephrine molecules begin to bind to adrenergic receptors, thereby additionally stimulating them. With time, because norepinephrine transporter is now blocked, in the same fashion, even monorepinephrine molecules begin to accumulate in the synapse. The higher the amount of norepinephrine molecules in the synapse, the higher the stimulation of adrenergic receptors, and thereby, potentially, the better becomes the mood and the more energy increase. So bupropion inhibits the function of norepinephrine transporter. This causes decrease in reuptake of norepinephrine from the synapse. Thereby, the amount of norepinephrine molecules in the synapse increase, and the higher the amount of norepinephrine molecules in the synapse, the higher the adrenergic effect, and thereby the better becomes the mood and the more energy increase. But also, bupropion inhibits the function of dopamine transporter. And to explain this, we have to know how dopaminergic neurons work. So, we have presynaptic neuron, synapse, and postsynaptic neuron. Dopaminergic neurons uptake tyrosine. Once tyrosine appears inside the neuron, tyrosine undergo hydroxylation by the rate-limiting enzyme tyrosine hydroxylase with formation of L-DOPA. Then L-DOPA by DOPA decarboxylase is converted to dopamine. Once dopamine is formed, vesicular monoamine transporter puts dopamine inside the vesicles. And inside the vesicles, dopamine is stored inside the neuron. But once depolarization occurs, neuron pushes vesicle into the synapse. We call this process exocytosis. As a result, vesicle becomes destroyed and dopamine molecules income to the synapse. On postsynaptic neuron, we have numerous dopaminergic receptors. Once dopamine molecules appear in the synapse, most of them immediately bind to dopaminergic receptors and activate them. Some of the dopamine molecules bind to dopamine autoreceptor on presynaptic neuron. With activation, this receptor inhibits the exocytosis of dopamine vesicles into the synapse. So this receptor provides reciprocal regulation. But what happens to dopamine molecules that simply did not have time to bind to any receptor? On presynaptic neuron, we have a dopamine transporter called DAT. This transporter uptakes free dopamine molecules and delivers them back to the presynaptic neuron, where the big bad boy monoamine oxidase B waiting for them. Most of the delivered dopamine molecules have a tragic fate. Monoamine oxidase uptake and destroy them. But some dopamine molecules are able to slip away from monoamine oxidase, and such molecules income to dopamine molecules, thereby replenishing dopamine pool. Bupropion inhibits the function of dopamine transporter. With inhibition of dopamine transporter, the reuptake of dopamine into the presynaptic neuron decreases. So, more dopamine molecules will remain in the synapse, where now these free dopamine molecules begin to bind to dopaminergic receptors, thereby additionally stimulating them. With time, because dopamine transporter is now blocked, in the same fashion, even more dopamine molecules accumulate in the synapse. The higher the amount of dopamine molecules in the synapse, the higher the stimulation of dopaminergic receptors, and thereby, potentially, the better becomes the mood and the more energy increase. So, bupropion inhibits the function of dopamine transporter. This causes decrease in reuptake of dopamine from the synapse, thereby, the amount of dopamine molecules in the synapse increase, and the higher the amount of dopamine molecules in the synapse, the higher the dopaminergic effect, and thereby the better becomes the mood and the more energy increase. Nowadays, bupropion is used in treatment of major depressive disorder, but only as a second-line option, because as a first-line drugs, we use selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors and selective norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors. In addition to this, bupropion can be used for smoking cessation, which is a unique feature. But bupropion has two significant side effects. The first problem is that bupropion causes significant stimulation of adrenergic receptors, and increase in adrenergic effect can cause increase in heart rate, headache, and insomnia. The second problem is that bupropion increases stimulation of dopaminergic receptors, and overstimulation of dopaminergic receptors can provoke seizures. So, because bupropion increases adrenergic stimulation, it can cause increase in heart rate and insomnia. And because bupropion also increases dopaminergic stimulation, it significantly increases the risk of seizures. But the positive aspect of this drug is that because bupropion do not affect serotonin neurons, this drug has a lesser risk to cause sexual dysfunction or weight gain, which are the common features of antidepressants that act through the serotonin receptors.